Congregation may be seated. We're going to take up our Bibles now. The passage for today's sermon is Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verses 1 to 14. You may follow as I read from the slides. Chapter 7, verse 1. A good name is better than precious ointment, and the day of death than the day of birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. For this is the end of all mankind, and the living will lay it to heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of face the heart is made glad. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. It is better for a man to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. For as the crackling of thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fools. This also is vanity. Surely oppression drives the wise into madness, and a bribe corrupts the heart. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning, and the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Be not quick in your spirit to become angry, for anger lodges in the heart of fools. Say not, "Why were the former days better than these?" For it is not from wisdom that you ask this. Wisdom is good with an inheritance, an advantage to those who see the sun. For the protection of wisdom is like the protection of money, and the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of him who has it. Consider the work of God. Who can make straight what he has made crooked? Verse 14, in the day of prosperity be joyful, and in the day of adversity consider. God has made the one as well as the other, so that man may not find out anything that will be after him. We'll send the children off to their class with a short prayer. So not many children today, maybe some at home watching. Let's pray together. Children, we close our eyes. We are going to pray. And children, you have to speak a bit louder. Follow me, because there are few of you. Can? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can be in your house. We thank you for singing the song about the shepherd of our souls. Thank you for Jesus, our shepherd. He loves us and feeds us. Help us to listen to his voice and to follow him every day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, children. You have been very good today. Please go to your class, and we'll see you at the end of service. The speaker for adults today is Pastor Dave.
Well, good evening. Let's try again. Good evening. It's really great to see all of you here. We hope to see everyone come back in person as soon as possible so that we can all worship the Lord together. As we're continuing our sermon series in the book of Ecclesiastes, it would be great if you could have your Bibles opened or switched on to the first half of chapter 7, verses 1 to 14. That's going to be really helpful. But why don't I start by going to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we ask that through your word and by your Holy Spirit, you show us the hope that is Jesus. Amen. Well, this year marks the 10th year since my ordination. That is to say, 10 years ago, I was ordained by the BB Church to become a minister of the gospel, a pastor. And as a pastor, I've had the privilege of being present, together with many of you, at the significant moments of life. I get to be there at happy moments, right? Joyous occasions of celebration and hope, like weddings. So many weddings. And births, too. I visit the hospital or home as soon as a new baby is born, to encourage and pray with the parents. In fact, I've had to do 3 visits this month. And later, if they have good theology, I get to baptize the kids too. But as a pastor, I'm also there in the unhappy moments. Difficult occasions of sadness and grief. Visit the hospital when a brother or sister is going through life-threatening illness. And of course, I conduct wakes and funerals when one has died, been lost to the grave, where there is much sorrow, more so if they did not know the Lord. But if you asked me a few years ago as a new pastor, which of these events do I feel more called to? You know, more called to. I mean, it was a no-brainer. I'd always pick the happy occasions, right? The ones with joy and gladness, laughter and singing. In fact, I was looking at my statistics, and numbers don't lie. I have conducted more than 50 weddings and visited dozens of newborns, spent copious amounts of time with about more than 100 young couples. But when I checked the calendar for hospital visits or for wakes or funerals, well, let's just say the numbers are significantly lower. Is it really because I'm younger by age? It's not really my season for these things? Or was it more that I felt awkward and uncomfortable to be there at that place of vulnerability and human frailty, the place of death, where we meet our inevitable end? So I wonder if you, like myself, find it curious to hear what Solomon says this week. Better is the day of death than the day of birth. Better to go to the house of mourning than the house of feasting. Better to be sorrowful than full of laughter. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. Solomon, if you remember, has been conducting the great experiment. He's been on a quest to uncover the meaning of life, to find out the purpose of our existence and toil. And so far, he's been met by many dead ends. The pursuit of pleasure, a hedonistic lifestyle, left him hollow and empty. The accumulation of knowledge was disappointing at best when he realized all his learning would soon be forgotten. Climbing the corporate ladder, wanting to be first, was only fueled by envy and caused oppression and injustice. Amassing money, as we heard last week, is an insatiable appetite that leads to indigestion and insomnia, and inevitably, all your wealth will be taken away. For naked we came and naked we return. Well, what about God then? Is the answer to fear God? Yes, but if we're honest, when we go to the house of God, We go not to listen to his word or to seek his will, but armed with our own agenda, we come filled with pious words that mask mercenary dreams. There is no fear of God before our eyes. What then is the meaning of life? Where is the place that we can find some semblance of answer? Where can wisdom be found? Solomon's next venture, as we've read, is to turn to the grave. And here, perhaps more than anywhere else, he finds the clearest of answers. This is how he starts. A good name is better than precious ointment. This gives us a clue into what Solomon is driving at. Expensive perfume makes us smell good, can dress us up for a while, but dissipates quickly. But a good name, a good reputation, is far more robust, more long-lasting. And that's what we're going to see from this section, that the cemetery is the school of survival. The cemetery is the best place to learn how to survive this life. This is what he says. The day of death is better than the day of birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. For this is the end of all mankind, and here the living will lay it to heart. The grave, as we well know, is a place of mourning, a place of sorrow. And when we face death, it hits us powerfully. We are overwhelmed with emotions of loss and sadness, of anger and frustration, and even fear that not only has a loved one passed, but this will be our fate also. And it's really hard to remain in that space, to stare at the black hole of our inevitable future. That's why in some Western funerals, they no longer keep the body around. In fact, just 2 days ago, a friend from Canada was texting, lamenting that he could not mourn death. People only wanted to celebrate life. And even in our local funerals, the body is usually kept some distance away. We only look at the person for a few seconds to pay respects, then quickly head off to the tables where either people play mahjong or for some bizarre reason talk about real estate. This one I don't understand. Why must talk about real estate at the wake service? Because the person's house on the market, is it? But anything, right? That we don't have to think about death, any stupid topic that distracts us can also. It's the same with hospitals, right? Make them as sterile or as hotel-like as possible so that we don't have to face mortality, vulnerability, frailty. Put the cemeteries far, far away. Scatter the ashes to the wind so that they no longer trigger us. You know, one event that made me realize how avoidant I was my grandmother's wake. It was impactful not just because she was a relative, but rather how the community handled her death. First, her body was placed in the house, not outside somewhere, but the coffin was right in the house, the living room. And next, friends and family came round, and they actually would stay a long periods of time. Many would fast or only eat simple vegetarian cuisine. It was time for mourning. And often they would go to the coffin to stare at her face, sometimes even to gently caress. And then they would speak words, tell stories, sing songs, read verses. It's a very different experience. It's not that they were immune or numb to death. There was plenty of grief. The room often felt heavy. There were long periods of silence. There was sadness, but they refused to run away from the sadness. After that event, I decided to do some research on other funeral practices. And I found that some Jews, when a brother or sister died, they would not outsource the process to an undertaker. They would handle their relative's body themselves, including the washing and the dressing. The loved one never left their side until he or she was buried in the ground. They acquainted themselves with grief. They were willing to be people of sorrow, to be acquainted with grief. But what benefit is there to this? Why does Solomon say it is better to be acquainted with grief, to face up to something like death, to remain in that tragic space and not run away? Well, Solomon gives us a few reasons. First, he says, it's a wake-up call. It is better for a man to hear the rebuke of a wise friend than to hear the song of fools. It is better for a man to hear the rebuke of the wise than to hear the song of fools. When we face our end, it is a good and necessary wake-up call for us to adjust how we're living. It is like the rebuke of a friend, like a medical report from a doctor. You know, just last year, the Health Promotion Board notified me that I was past 40, a few years ago, and was now eligible for a $2 health screening. I hadn't gone for a screening in years, so I thought, better go. Why not, right? I took the test. A few days later, got the result. It told me it's perfectly healthy. All my results were optimal. Yeah, it's not an illustration, it's just an update that I'm healthy, so stop asking me about my weight. But imagine if the doctor had said, you are overweight, your blood pressure is too high, your cholesterol is in the danger zone, and you're at risk of a full-on heart attack. That is a rebuke. A shock to the system. But it would be good for me, then I can alter my lifestyle. I think after the first attack in our men's ministry, many of our middle-aged men quickly went for screening, and a couple realized they had to change. But contemplating on death is like that. Cold water in the face to help us live better, last longer. When we go for celebrations, life's good moments, it often makes us think we're indestructible. Life is an open book. Everything is possible. But that is naive, Solomon says. Go to the house of mourning. Face death. This is life's reality. This. The second reason Solomon says that the day of death is better is because of the effect it has on the heart. Did you see that? By sadness of face, the heart is made glad. The heart of the wise is found in the house of mourning. By sadness, the heart is made glad. Or in other versions, sadness has a refining influence on our hearts. It seems that the more we contemplate our end, yes, the sadder our faces, the more weary our countenance, grief will age us. But internally, it is good for us. The heart is cleansed, refined, literally scourged of all its needless wants and desires, of all its mindless, insatiable appetites that get us into trouble. The heart becomes wise. Even the great Moses echoed this, right? That it is only when we number our days that we get a heart of wisdom. I mean, have a look with me at this report from nurses who collected reflections from hospice patients, you know, people at the end of their days. This is what they thought about life. This is what they said. I wish I hadn't worked so hard or chose more meaningful work. I wish I had the courage to express my feelings to those around me. I wish I had more friends or stayed more in touch with friends. I wish I hadn't taken my family members for granted. I wish I'd taken more risks in life, pursued my dreams. I wish I'd served others more, done more acts of kindness and compassion. And in almost all the surveys, I wish I was happier. I wish I was happier. Good advice? Is this wisdom? It seems that only at the end of life do we get clarity on what is worth doing and what is a total waste of time. But the heart of fools is found in the house of mirth. Fools, on the other hand, are in the house of celebration. They are partying and drinking and laughing and singing and saying stupid things, ever the comedian, always wanting to make light the situation, alleviate the tension, ignore the reality, keep things fun and positive. It'll be all right in the end. For as the crackling of thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of fools. Or in another version, a fool's laughter is quickly gone like thorns crackling in a fire. The fool's laughter doesn't last very long. Eventually, the harshness of life catches up with you. The alcohol turns to cirrhosis, the rich food to diabetes, the callousness into cancer, comedy turns to tragedy. No wonder Jesus said, "Blessed are you who weep, but woe are to you who laugh now." We must never be jealous of those who are constantly publicizing the good life, especially on social media. Or it will make you mad, Solomon says. It will crush you if you listen to them. In fact, I've come to this personal hypothesis. The more people tend to show off their happy outside, the sadder their inside. The more people publicize their happy outside, the sadder their inside. Thirdly, not only is the heart refined by the grave, but so is the spirit. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning, and the patient of spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Thinking about how we finish, or finishing well, as Pastor David used to say, is better than starting. As we contemplate the destination, this is how our spirit learns patience, or literally long-suffering. The wise learn to count the costs before they start the journey. They are better prepared to deal with the inevitable ups and downs. They are more ready to tahan the trials and failures. Be not quick in your spirit to become angry, for anger lodges in the bosom of fools. Say not, "Why were the former days better than these?" For it is not from wisdom that you ask this. The fool, on the other hand, is quick to speak, quick to start, and is often boastful about his plans and projects. However, the fool's spirit is easily inflated, and it explodes. When things don't go his or her way, they get upset. "Why things like that? Last time better, you know." Sound familiar? "Why things like that? Last time better, you know." Complain, complain, complain. The fool is easily disrupted. But those that know death may be long in face, but they also long in spirit. They're more resilient, so to speak. The fool may seem carefree, but in reality, they're extremely fragile. Unable to handle adversity, they react in rage. Or to use a current term, the fool is the one who will rage quit on you. So there it is. When we take the time to meditate on the finality of our existence, yes, it is a rude shock to the system, but if we, as Martin Luther once said, invite death into our presence, even when it is still at a distance, if we are to invite death into our presence, even when it is still at a distance, then our minds have clarity, our hearts are refined, and our spirits tempered. To use Solomon's phrase, we are better equipped to live this life under the sun. We are more ready to face the harshness of a toilsome life. It's like an inheritance, he says. An inheritance protects you from harshness, from facing the worst society has to offer. As those who are not so fortunate often comment, "What do you know about life? You were born with a silver spoon." There is truth to that. Money, especially inheritance money, shelters you, helps you ride out the storms. But so does the wisdom we learn from the funeral parlor. Knowing our final enemy steadies our hand for the battle. Wisdom, like an inheritance, is an advantage to those who will see the sun. You know, after 10 years of pastoral ministry, perhaps now I am beginning to recognize some of these as truth. That firstly, it is a privilege, never a burden, to minister to people in tragic situations like sickness and bereavement. It is a privilege to be there. But secondly, the more time I spend with people at the tail end of their lives, the more clarity I have in my own life. It is easier to see what is wise and what is the pursuit of fools. And begin to see how these words make sense. Better is the day of death than the day of birth. Better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting. Better to be sorrowful than full of laughter. Better is the end of a thing than its beginning. Well, Solomon concludes. My friends, he says, life is not predictable. God is going to keep throwing curveballs at you. Plan and prepare all you want, but you have no idea what will happen next. There will be many more spanners coming your way, and COVID is the tip of the iceberg. So if you want to survive, my friends, if you want to last the distance in this difficult life, let me give you my best advice. On a good day, enjoy the fruit of your labor. Eat, drink, and take pleasure in your toil. Know that it is the gift of God. Say thank you. And on a bad day, when God sends tragedy, and yes, it is God sending the tragedy, stop, think, reflect. Meditate that one day your life will come to an abrupt end. On the day of prosperity, rejoice. And on the day of adversity, reflect. Because unless there is some answer to the grave, then this, my friends, is as good as it gets. This is all life has to offer us. We'll see you at the next funeral. Perhaps it'll be your funeral. Amen.